So, welcome everyone. My name is Stephen Goodman, and I teach in the Asian and Comparative Studies program here at CIIS, California Institute of Integral Studies. How many of you, is this your first time here? Wow. May it not be your last. We have a, if you're interested in different events that we have here, or general information about Asian Comparative Studies, we host a lot of events, even in summertime. And so we actually have, this is very old fashioned, pen and parchment. So if you're motivated and you want to know about events, and we're really very, very proactive in letting people know, sort of friends of Asian Comparative Studies. So there's that, pass around. And we have a great program for you tonight. Matteo Pistono, our guest lecturer, who many of us have known. We could have a contest about how long we've known each other. I can't even remember. I don't know the first time we met him. It was possibly a Rigpa event. Many of you know a book that's really made quite a splash, In the Shadow of the Buddha, One Man's Journey of Discovery in Tibet. And then just a few years after that, and hardly any research was involved, something like 15 years, just spectacular book, Fearless in Tibet, The Life of the Mystic Tertön Sogyal. And he graciously has agreed, after his presentation and slideshow and a few questions and answers, to sign his books as he has them here. He's also a great aficionado of the art of tea, and I had the great pleasure of spending a short 4 hours with him doing such recently. And he's a great raconteur, a dear friend, and so please help me welcome Matteo.
Thanks so much. I would like to call Stephen Professor, but thanks, Stephen, and thanks for the invitation, and also thanks to Rigpa San Francisco. They helped bring some folks here and get the word out. So as Stephen said, I'm just going to talk for maybe 40, 45 minutes and show some slides to go through the life of Tertön Sogyal a little bit, the journey of writing the book, and then we will, then we can have a discussion, and that would be good. So I think we'll just get right to it. My own journey of writing this book about Tertön Sogyal started when I first saw this photograph at a Buddhist center in London when I went to study there for my master's degree. I was studying Buddhist philosophy there. Some of you know Dominique Seid. We did our MA together there. And she actually took me. She said, "I've got this teacher named Sogyal Rinpoche. You want to go meet him?" So she took me there. And at this Buddhist center in London was this large photograph. And I was completely struck by the image itself. I had no idea who it was at the time. But I stayed on in London to do my degree there. I started studying with the person whose Dharma center it was associated with. It was called Rigpa. And the Lama that's associated with that, I know some of this. Let me just excuse it for a moment. Some of you are like Sogyal Rinpoche students, but I have to explain, it's a very, very crowd. So forgive me if I say things that you already know. But this Lama's reincarnation is Sogyal Rinpoche, the author of the Tibetan Book of Living and Dying. And it was his Dharma Center in London where I was. And I began studying with Sogyal Rinpoche at the time. But I was very much interested in this photograph of Tertön Sogyal. And I asked Sogyal Rinpoche, I asked every Lama I could come in contact with, I asked historians, Chinese, Tibetans, and nobody could really tell me much about Tertön Sogyal, except that he was the teacher to the 13th Dalai Lama, the Dalai Lama who was the previous to the current, and that he was a great tantric adept. That was about it. There was a few stories, but nobody could really get into the life story of Tertön Sogyal. So after I finished my degree in London, I asked Sogyal Rinpoche, I suggested that I wanted to go study the life of Tertön Sogyal in Tibet. And he said, actually at the time, he said, I even mentioned this in that first book that Stephen mentioned. He said, if you really want to find the ultimate guru, you don't have to go anywhere. But go ahead and go. And so I went to follow in Tertön Sogyal's footsteps in Tibet. And Sogyal Rinpoche suggested that I go meet another incarnation of Tertön Sogyal by the name of Kenpo Jigme Punsok. And for those of you who, he's holding Tertön Sogyal's purba in his hand here. So I went to see Kenpo Jigme Punsok, and I went to this area here. It's a place called Golok. It was super remote then, when Tertön Sogyal was there. It's even remote now. It's about as far away from anywhere as that you can get. When I went to see Kenpo Jigme Punsok, he suggested that I go to four places in the life of Tertön Sogyal. So these four significant places, and of course the map is not the journey, but I sort of started. And the first place I went to was where Tertön Sogyal's spiritual life began. And it was at this little hermitage below this magnificent peak in Nyarong. Tertön Sogyal was born in 1856. He did not have the sort of life that you read about of these about some lamas, where you hear that recognizes a reincarnation very young. They're sort of swept up in silken robes and placed on a high throne, and the rest is sort of enlightened history. Tertön Sogyal was not like that at all. In fact, his father wanted his son to have nothing to do with any sort of Buddhist training or any sort of Buddhist lamas. So he actually withheld him from studying with any lamas. And instead, he encouraged him to become a very skilled at yak herding as a marksman, of which he was a very good one. And later, in his late teens, he sent him off to study as a bandit. And so Tertön Sogyal's late teenage years was as a bandit. And he was a kind of a leader by nature, but he was a super good marksman, except when he aimed at something that was alive. And when he aimed at something that was alive, like a person or an animal, he would have these visions that would pop up along the sights of the gun, or sort of just, and they were sometimes Buddhist deities, sometimes there were syllables of mantra that would block his sights. After this time with the bandits, he got very sick. And one mendicant lama told his mother that the reason that Tertön Sogyal was sick was because he was handling weapons of violence. That's why he kept on getting sick. And he would die if he continued to do so. So after much going back and forth, and I sort of write about this, I sort of think of this a little bit, of that, you know, that scene in Star Wars where Luke Skywalker wants to go study with Obi-Wan Kenobi? And he's sort of like, come on, uncle, like, I just want to go study. And the mother says, come on, you know, let's just let him go study. It's a little bit like that. I mean, Tertön Sogyal really wanted to go study with this great master who was living here. Finally, his mother relented and allowed him to go there. When Tertön Sogyal went there, he met a great lama by the name of Nala Pema Dundel. And for those of you who aren't familiar with Tibetan names, you can just let the names flow off you. There may be a few that will be coming here. But point is that he was a great yogi and hermit, Nala Pema Dundel. And Tertön Sogyal went to study with him, although he didn't stay with him for very long, because Nala Pema Dundel sent him to study with his principal disciple, lama, by the name of Lama Sonam Thai. And Tertön Sogyal began a series of retreats that would last about a decade, a little bit over a decade. And he would study with some of these hermits, and then he began studying with three principal teachers. The first was Noshul Longpuk, who Tertön Sogyal really studied. His Dzogchen training was really with Noshul Longpuk. And then he went to study with Jamyang Khyentse Wangpo, who very much oversaw his later training, if you will. And he studied and also collaborated with Jamgon Hontrol, these masters. And so Tertön Sogyal went into these remote areas in eastern Tibet like this and would spend months and months in retreat. He received the teachings, he contemplated them, and then the teachings became part of him. He was the teaching itself. There's many, and I write about this in the book, during this time, some people saw Tertön Sogyal as a great scholar. Others sort of saw him like some crazed yogi running around. Others saw him as a sort of serious hermit. Some saw him as a scholar. It sort of depended on the disposition, but Tertön Sogyal was going through many different phases, if you will, and it says in his biography, which I'll talk a little bit, not the one that I wrote, but one in Tibetan, that there was this deep, deep catharsis that was going on. When that fully was cleansed, then he began to have these visionary experiences. And so these visionary experiences began arising in him, but after this decade or so, it's about 11 years in retreat, what happened was in Lhasa, in central Tibet, the Tibetan government was there, got wind of this great yogi who they heard mantras and his prayers and his rituals that he performed could actually affect physical phenomena, that he could stop thunder clouds, he could defend borders, he could stop armies. There was this belief, and the central Tibetan government was all over this. And so they sent essentially Pony Express, because they wanted a tantric yogi like this. They wanted his rituals to be used for a political purpose. Yeah. So they sent a message for Tertön Sogyal to come to Lhasa, and it was the first of 5 visits. Tertön Sogyal was continually in his 30s, into his 50s, was continually going back and forth between Lhasa and eastern Tibet, which was about a 6-month journey back and forth. So when Tertön Sogyal went there, he met, of course, the 13th Dalai Lama. This is a little bit older, because Tertön Sogyal was about 20 years the senior to the 13th Dalai Lama. But it says when he first went there that the Dalai Lama did ask him to become his guru, and their minds merged like water being poured into water, a very sort of beautiful image. And you know, my own sense of Tertön Sogyal and the 13th and the 14th Dalai Lama is one of this very much engaged with society or with the problems that they are presented with, but that outer phenomena never disturbs this inner yearning, if you will, to benefit all beings. It never sort of shakes that stable foundation. I want to say something here so that was the second place. The Potala Palace in particular, and also the Jokong that Kenpo told me to go to. I want to take a step back for just a moment to talk, because it's central to who Tertön Sogyal was, and I have to introduce just go over a little bit of history, if you will. When Buddhism was introduced to Tibet, when Buddhism was established, we should say, in the 8th century, by Padmasambhava, it was done so by a king. The king of Tibet at the time invited Padmasambhava to come to Tibet to establish the Dharma. There had been earlier attempts, but they really needed a sort of tough love type of guru that we find in Padmasambhava. So they invited Padmasambhava to come to Tibet. And what we had playing out at this time was Tibet's territorial influence was as large as it ever has been in their history. They had their territory reached well almost all of China. As far south, there's pillars as far south as Bihar in India, and as far west as into Afghanistan. Their horsemen, their marshal, the army was such. This at the time when Padmasambhava was invited to come, and at this time he was invited to come. It's said that he stayed maybe 50 years, maybe 54 years. Not exactly certain, but what we had take place at this time was we had an establishment of Buddhism at the time when there was the greatest sense of nationhood, of nationalism. I'll call it national. They didn't call it nationalism then, at this time in the 8th century. So you had the leader of Tibet in the king, and you had Padmasambhava collaborating in this great endeavor to establish this sense of nationhood at the same time that Buddhism was introduced. When Padmasambhava left Tibet after 50 years, he told the Tibetans that that there'll be trouble in the future. There's a chair here. Okay. When Padmasambhava left Tibet, he said, "There's going to be trouble in the future, but I can give you I can give you solutions or antidotes to those problems that are going to arise. And they're going to arise in two different ways. The principal way, the main reason, is because you hard-headed Tibetans, are going to fight amongst each other. You're going to have this internal discord. And this internal discord is going to deplete your storehouse of positive merit. And in doing so, you're going to be vulnerable from outside forces. So Guru Rinpoche Padmasambhava said, I'm going to give you methods, I'm going to give you antidotes to recuperate that storehouse of positive karma. And I'm going to do that in the form of teachings I'm going to give you, in the forms of statues I'm going to give to you, and prophecies and advice. He said, I'm not going to give them all to you right now, but I'm going to hide them throughout the land in the form of treasures. In two principal ways, in the form of earth treasures, and then I'm going to also hide them sort of in the earth, trees, mountains, lakes. I'm also going to hide them within the mind stream of my 25 principal disciples. And the reincarnations of those 25 disciples in the progressive centuries are going to rediscover these treasures that I'm hiding right now, and these will be the antidotes to the spiritual malaise of the time. So when Padmasambhava, he was going to hide them in the form of texts, statues like this. Some of you may even have been blessed by this statue, this Vajrakilaya statue that Tertön Sogyal discovered. But Padmasambhava had these 25 disciples, and he said the reincarnations of these 25 disciples will be the treasure revealers, or the Tertöns. And that's where that word Tertön, as in Tertön Sogyal, Tertön is a title, it means revealer of treasures. And at the time, there was one of those 25 disciples was a great Vajrakilaya adept by the name of Nanam Dorje Dujum. And he reincarnated in the 9th century as Tertön Sogyal. So what we have is Tertön Sogyal, when he came to Lhasa to meet the 13th Dalai Lama, you had something playing out that had happened, a sort of reenactment of what happened in this great grand era in the 8th century, when the leader of Tibet, who at the time was the king, but now you have the 13th Dalai Lama being the leader of Tibet, and you have Padmasambhava, who established Buddhism in Tibet, and now you have the revealer of Padmasambhava's treasure, meeting. And we see in Tibetan history, whenever this has taken place, the Dalai Lama's activities have always flourished. Whenever they hook up with their destined Tertön, their activity very much flourishes. You see this with the 5th Dalai Lama, you see this with the 13th Dalai Lama, and you see this with the 14th Dalai Lama, which I'll talk about maybe during the question. Somebody asked me about that, who it was that the 14th Dalai Lama hooked up with in terms of his Tertön, because it expands their activity. The third place I was encouraged to go was one of these places that Kempo told me to go, was one of these places where Tertön Sogyal had revealed a treasure. In his life, he revealed thousands of treasures. Some of them were texts, some of them were prayers, some of them were many volumes of teachings. And I talk a lot about the Fearless in Tibet, how that took place. Because as I mentioned, sometimes Padmasambhava hid it in his mind stream. So Tertön Sogyal would sometimes there would be some sort of condition that would be presented by him. Maybe he would see a statue or perhaps some sort of writing that was associated with that text. And it was almost as if it was a mnemonic device, and he would remember that in the 8th century and this treasure would be revealed. And then he would just write it down. When I went to these places, that Tertön Sogyal, this actually was a cave, and sort of you just go up and you have to go way back in. I would go to these places and try to do what Sogyal Rinpoche was telling me to do, or as it was written in the text, and it was to practice these treasure teachings that Tertön Sogyal was revealing. So I would go there and try to do my best to sort of try to understand what Tertön Sogyal was doing. The fourth place was just beyond these mountains where Tertön Sogyal died in 1927. That's the fourth place. So these, let me see here. So this pilgrimage began that took me about 10 years to go to these four places. I was living in Kathmandu at the time. And I went to many different places along the way, got distracted a lot. But it took me about a decade to finally find the fourth place was difficult to find. And I wrote about, as Stephen mentioned, I wrote about that journey, my own sort of journey, in the Shadow of the Buddha. And what I actually did when I got there, perhaps you, from one perspective you could say one of the distractions, but what I ended up doing during this period was I started working for a human rights organization and collecting documentation of human rights abuses and taking photographs, especially in eastern Tibet, of the prison system which houses monks and nuns. And so when I knew who was there, I would sort of take photographs of them. And I was working through these human rights organizations in Washington, D.C., and in Europe to bring this information to Western governments. I also wrote about Tertön Sogyal in that book because it was these two journeys that sort of are woven as these two threads in the Shadow of the Buddha. But as I mentioned, in going to these, in following all of these places in Tertön Sogyal's life, I went to many different sites that are associated with Tertön Sogyal, like this, where he actually never went here to Mount Kailash, but he considered it the center of the universe, so I thought I would go there, to extraordinary lakes where Tertön Sogyal had, and other masters like Chogyal Rinpoche had revealed termas from here, to collect the water, oftentimes, just and or to these hermitages, where Tertön Sogyal stayed, but many masters had stayed there throughout the centuries, and also in particular to meet statues that Tertön Sogyal, and this is probably the most significant statue that Tertön Sogyal revealed. For those of you who have gone to the central cathedral in Lhasa, called the Jokhang, if you're facing the central image, it's right to the Buddha's right hand of Padmasambhava. And it was when this actual in 1891 he discovered this, and when they brought the statue in, it was this gigantic parade that they brought in as if Padmasambhava himself was returning to Lhasa, and also statues like this, which are sort of aspects of Vajrakilaya that Tertön. So I would try to go and meet these type of statues on pilgrimage. This was most oftentimes the way. There were sort of two ways. I would get together with monks or some of the Tibetan friends and hire a truck, buy some barley flour, jump in the back, and drive for a week or four to these holy places. And most oftentimes, try not to be on the inside of the rubbing in the back. But in the summertime, sometimes the roads aren't they get completely washed out. The most efficient way definitely was to go by motorbike. This is Omni Machen, right in the center in Golo, a very holy mountain, going to Numbur Yutse. We would get nomads, and you sort of get like almost like a chauffeur that you would go along. On this occasion, I was with my wife, and we hired these two sort of banderos. This guy wasn't so certain that he wasn't going to ride off with my wife into the sunset. Definitely my favorite way to go was to go by horseback on these short Tibetan ponies. And this was going on the route from Derge back to Dzongzar, that when Dogo Kenshi Rinpoche went back on his journey. So we were actually following in the same route that he went. But eventually you end up having to walk. And you can sort of see here, that was my buddy. And we were actually told just to go just to the shrine there, to make an offering there before we actually went to a different location to the main pilgrimage site. So these things sometimes have a progressive quality to it. The Tibetan word for pilgrimage is nekor. Ne means a holy place, and kor means to walk around. So in going to these places, we might be walking around these very holy caves where Tertön Sogyal and other Tertöns had revealed treasures. It might be entire mountain ranges, which could take a couple weeks, like in the southeastern part. Or it could be lakes and mountains combined. I should mention here, at the end of Tertön Sogyal's life, he had some unfinished business. There were about 12 treasures or texts that he hadn't completed. And he hid them. He put them back because they were incomplete. And he put them back here in this mountain range. And he said that my next my next incarnation shall reveal these. And Kenpo Jingmi Punso, who you saw earlier with the dagger, he went there to try to find it, and he didn't find them. And when he met Sogyal Rinpoche in 1993, he asked Sogyal Rinpoche, he said, I wasn't able to do it, now it's your turn.
Oh,
but Sogyal Rinpoche hasn't been back to Tibet since then. Or you go to these caves, cave systems like this, which is right along the Yellow River, and the photograph of Tertön Sogyal, that the very first photograph, was taken just in a home, in a house, a very humble house, but at the base of this, where these caves are. And you know, I grew up in Wyoming, so going to Tibet, I felt very familiar in a sense with the wilderness, with the wide open sky, with the exposure to the elements. It was something that I very much, the sort of atmosphere that I love to be in. But in going repeatedly back to Tibet, and I went on about 13 or 14 trips during that 10-year time that would last anywhere from a month to 3 months, been traveling. It sort of switched. My mind began to switch, I think, because originally I would sort of see a scene like this, maybe, to be just wilderness. It was completely wild in a sense. But in traveling with these lamas and with the monks and these yogis, I began, I think, to have a glimpse that for them it wasn't this wild scene, this wilderness in the way that we understand it. It was quite the contrary. It was very much a place that is inhabited by clan spirits, by ancestral deities, and in particular, imbued with a blessing by all of these past lamas that have been there. So their movement through this space is as if they're moving through a mandala. It's not as though they're just going to sort of trekking through this beautiful nature. And that is one reason, I think, why Tibetans have such a strong sense of, they're so strongly attached to their land, if you will, because it's not just the land itself, but it's who and what resides there, these deities and the power of this blessing. In going, I always was trying to go to places where people knew something about Tertön Sogyal. So here in Nyarong is actually the room where Tertön Sogyal was born. His home, it was a very humble home where he lived, so it wasn't destroyed during the Cultural Revolution. If it would have been one more story, it would have been razed. But it wasn't. It was kind of just a one story. It had where the animals stay in the bottom, and there was just big open room. And they're not the blood family of Tertön Sogyal, but they know who he is. In the first book, I wrote about One-Eyed Wangdi. This is One-Eyed Wangdi. And he was the one who really opened up the whole of the monastery, of Kaltang Monastery, and let me see Tertön Sogyal's sort of articles and his blessed objects. This is the Lama who I received the printed biography of Tertön Sogyal, and at the time, I didn't actually have a copy. I didn't know that there was one at the time. And this is, you can even see here, it was back in the day when we used cassette recorders to record. I was recording the conversation on cassette. But, and he, they printed on woodblocks there, and he had been responsible for, during the Cultural Revolution, he hid the library. It was all of these woodblocks, and the biography itself of Tertön Sogyal would be about 300 of these woodblocks. He hid thousands of them in the ground and in adobe walls, and for that, he spent about 18 years in prison for not only that, but being a lama. And so when I met him, I tried to spend as much time as I could with him, but he was the one who gave me the oral transmission for this text of the Tertön Sogyal's biography. This lama is still alive. He's in his 80s, and it's Tertön Sogyal's great-grandson.
Wow.
For those of you who know Tukul Jigme from Chagyur Rinpoche's son, he sort of takes care of him in a way. I mean, he supports him. And they do. He's a great lama there, and he doesn't really travel much. But when I went to see him, I knew that I wanted to write the story at that time. And I asked him for a blessing, and the day before I left, these sort of prayer beads around his neck, he took it off, and he took off one of the beads, and he said, wear this on your neck to bless your speech, meaning what you're writing, so you can bless the story of Tertön Sogyal. So I haven't taken off. That was, you know, maybe 12 years ago or something. But I'm happy to say that he's still alive, these old lamas. Lama Ajahn is also still alive, and he's the principal lineage holder of Tertön Sogyal's teramis in Nyarong today. And he also loves little blessing substances like a lot of Tibetans, but he really likes it. So the last time I went there, I asked him for it to break open his stash. And he gave me many, many different pills and this, and then he broke out his special stash where he gave me a bit of Tertön Sogyal's belt, a bit of his boot, a bit of his shirt, his shawl, his hair, and then the sort of crowning, the crown jewel of his of these substances. He gets, he rumbles back in the thing and he pulls out this carpet like this big, and it's a wolf pelt. And I, this was mentioned in the Tertön Sogyal's biography, because Tertön Sogyal didn't, he was always on the move, and he didn't hardly take anything with him, but this wolf pelt was something that he always had, he meditated on. So he grabbed his, you know, bowie knife, he had a knife here, just, and sort of like cuts, you know, takes off a big chunk of it, and like a lot of these lamas, he gave a big chunk for the Dalai Lama, a little bit smaller chunk for Sogyal Rinpoche, and then he sort of gave me, you know, a little bit. But it's those type of, you know, feeling, being with these people where I try to get a sense of who Tertön Sogyal was. And he's a real chadral. He almost always goes barefoot, even in the wintertime in Tibet. It's amazing lama. His name is Ajahn, Lama Ajahn. And this is the lama that took us to where Tertön Sogyal's, the photograph was born in Redcombe. He's still alive and is, yeah, like I said, it's sort of south of Redcombe where that photograph was taken. That's my wife. She's the best travel partner. And meeting Tertön Sogyal's family, his blood family, here at Lumarok Monastery, and this is actually all of the relatives of Lodi Gary Rinpoche, who some of you may know, who's the Dalai Lama's, or was the Dalai Lama's special envoy of Washington, D.C., a diplomat. But he's actually the blood lineage of Tertön Sogyal, and happened to be my boss for about 10 years. And so I always felt that I had sort of Gary Rinpoche's sort of, you know, at the blood lineage blessing from Tertön Sogyal, and then we have Sogyal Rinpoche, who is the mind, so you sort of get the best of both worlds being with the two lamas. This lama is one of, just a yogi who doesn't do a whole lot except practice Tertön Sogyal's teachings every moment, second of the day and night. And he had just come out of retreat, and he didn't have anything, but when I asked him for a blessing of Tertön Sogyal, as I oftentimes did, he said, okay, and he says, just sit here. And then he just didn't move, and his eyes just got a little bit larger, and he just remained. And it was as if I was completely engulfed in his view of whatever he did or whatever he wasn't doing, which is probably the case. But again, it was trying to connect with people like this to get a sense of what it was like to be in Tibet and among these great yogis. This yogini was, she really taught me a lot about sort of this spontaneous joy. She's actually the consort of this elderly lama who's no longer, he died at 92 about 2 years ago. It was like stepping back in the 17th century with this lama. He was out there. But this yogini, I spent quite a while with her, and I got to try to get a sense of what it would have been like with these great female practitioners, because she, and I tried to get a sense of who Tertön Sogyal's wife was like, because Tertön Sogyal's, he married quite early in his 30s, and his wife traveled with him a lot. Her name was Kondro Pumo. This is on her stupa, actually, where her ashes are kept in Yarong. And she was a great practitioner, and Nosho Kempo actually met her and writes about her a little bit, how she could control the weather, and that was sort of seemingly what people would always ask her to do. I don't think I would have asked her to control the weather. If she can control the weather, I probably would have asked for something else. But you know, you got to have the crops, I guess, in Tibet. You got to have the food in your belly. I want to say something about the writing of the sources of the biography, because I know some scholars and especially those who read Tibetan will want to know where I got the stories from. Because it has a storytelling element to it, and when I went to Tibet, I got this copy of this biography. When I came back, I found out that actually there was a better version or a more readable version in the library in Delhi, and it was written by this fellow by the name of Sultram Zangpo or Tsulu, And Sulu was a student of Tertön Sogyal for the last 15 years of his life. He was originally a student of Dodruk Tembenima. He was a very pure Gelugpa monk, as was throughout his life. But when he began to study with Dzogchen Rinpoche and then Tertön Sogyal, he brought these two sort of different languages together of the new school and the old school. And he's one of the Dalai Lama oftentimes talks about him, the current Dalai Lama, that he studies his teachings, philosophical teachings. In any case, when Tertön Sogyal died in 1926, Sulu started to write the biography and completed it in 1940 and had it carved in woodblocks at that time. The biography, as writing this biography, it was really what opened up who Tertön Sogyal was, because it has Tertön Sogyal's own words within it. There's some of his letters. There's a lot of colophones where he describes where he was at a particular time, because there aren't very many clues within it in a usual linear way if you're trying to read a biography. There's very little in the way of history in a linear way, and people in the biography are referred to by many different, a single individual will be referred to by many different names. It's almost as if they're trying to confuse the reader when you're reading it. It's difficult sometimes to know if something actually happened, if it was a vision, or if it's a prophecy of Guru Rinpoche that it should happen. And so I've spent about 6 months working on this book with a monk from Nechung Monastery who had probably more enthusiasm than myself about Tertön Sogyal. So we went through every page, we translated everything within it, and it was just an extraordinary time for me to sort of take a pilgrimage through Tertön Sogyal's biography. And much of that is included within Fearless in Tibet. Much of it is, but most of it isn't. Just because it is, that biography is still, it's called a secret biography. And so, not because, anyways, it's very difficult, very super, very esoteric. So as much as what we could put in Fearless in Tibet, I've tried to do so. And I've tried to weave within the book the blessings of the lamas that I received, principally from Sogyal Rinpoche and Kenpo Jigme Phunso here, that when they met, their only meeting in 1993 in France, in Larebling. Lodi Gyaru Rinpoche, who I mentioned earlier, he's, people don't know, but he's a great oral historian, especially from Eastern Tibet. And so I spent many hours with him, interviewing him. And the other Lama who was a real, who answered many, many, there were two Lamas alive who answered all of the questions that I had. When I couldn't understand things, I didn't go to them initially, but it was Khomtra Rinpoche, who is alive in Dharamsala today, and then Orgun Topgyal Rinpoche. These two lamas, you could just ask a little question like this, and they, you know, it would be hours. So you had to be careful about what questions you asked, but they were very much assisted in trying to understand these elements. And I went throughout went through China to meet individuals who held little kernels of understandings, like Puwang in Beijing, was a Wanggel, Kempo Namdo Rinpoche in Parping, and then of course His Holiness the Dalai Lama, who I met on two different occasions to talk about the book. The first time I met him, I thought it was going to be the interview about the Tertön Sogyal, and it went very quick because he just said, "Go to Tibet and talk to everybody there, and come back to me afterwards." So that was about it. Like, I didn't get to ask him anything. So I did, spent 7 years in Tibet, and I was finally able to go and sit down with him and show him. I had my computer there, and he wanted to see the pictures of all of the people I met. Mm. He didn't talk a lot about Tertön Sogyal. When I said, how does it feel when I say, even just say the name Tertön Sogyal, he just said, the great protector of Tibet. No, he said, a great protector of Tibet. But he just talked mainly about the teachings and the treasure of revelations. He didn't talk much about the personality or this. You know, I was kind of hoping, but that's okay. So this is actually a tanka of Tertön Sogyal, image that I included in the book, that has his thumbprints on the back. It was painted in It's in the sort of style of Rebcom. So if it was when Tertön Sogyal was there, it was in the 1915 to 1920 or so. But I am, you know, the Tsulu, the person that wrote the biography, this gigantic 725-page biography, at the very end of it, Tsulu says that it's nearly impossible to write the life story of Tertön Sogyal because he's so beyond any sort of concepts. But still, I have to write the biography. That's what he wrote. And so I kind of felt this, you know, I understood a little bit of what he was getting at when he wrote that. Because, but still, you know, it's a kind of paradox that I carried with me as I was going to all of these places that were associated with Tertön Sogyal. The last place I went to in 2008 was along this road by car, then by bus, then by motorbike, and then we walked through this valley, and we ended up coming here. And some, for those of you who have read in the Shadow of the Buddha, this is the last scene in there, where the first time I went, this wasn't here, this stupa. This is where Tertön Sogyal died in Golok in 1926. He actually died in this building here, or in this building, and this was a stupa that was by. This is a little temple, and those were some houses where the retreatants lived. After the first time I was there, I wanted to build a monument in honor of Tertön Sogyal, so I organized with the local nomads that live in the valley, and Sogyal Rinpoche got behind it financially, and it took him about 6 months to build this reliquary to Tertön Sogyal. And so in 2008, when I went back there, when Tibet was sort of on fire, all of the demonstrations were happening, but I was able to get back, and I took back this sort of silken bag that had all these relics that I collected from the Dalai Lama and from many different lamas, including relics of the Buddha, and they had sort of kept a door on the back. So when I went there and I climbed up on a ladder and they put it in there and closed it, I put a sign, and Sogyal Rinpoche had given the name to the stupa called the Stupa of Enlightenment of Tertön Sogyal, Victorious in All Directions. And I climbed down the ladder, and the feeling that I had at that time, there was a sense of completion, if you will, but because it was the last of the four places that Kenpo Jigme Punsoke had told me to go to. And that kind of feeling that I had then is the same feeling I had when I finished writing Fearless in Tibet. And it's that sense that, you know, whether you trace the life of the guru on pilgrimage routes or through the page and reading it, the masters are still pointing us to the same exact place that I mentioned right at the beginning, where Sogyal Rinpoche had said initially, that it points us to that place where you don't actually have to go anywhere at all, that place that is within, that's innate wakefulness. And whether it's on the page or on the pilgrimage, I think that that's where the masters are compassionately urging us towards all the time. So with that, I think I'll just have, you can have a discussion now, and then I can sign some books or something. Oh, let me say this. The 14th Dalai Lama, so the 5th Dalai Lama hooked up with Terdak Lingpa of Minderling Monastery, the 13th Dalai Lama was with Tertön Sogyal. The 14th Dalai Lama, the Tertön that was supposed to, at least who told the 14th Dalai Lama, I'm your Tertön, was Jamyang Khenchi Chökyi Lodro. When they met in 1954 in Lhasa, and Sogyal Rinpoche was 9 years old, that was the purpose of that meeting. And that was why the Dalai Lama said, whatever you say, it should be done. Of course, it wasn't done, because there were some hard-headed individuals in the court of the 14th Dalai Lama in Lhasa at the time. When he came into exile, fortunately, he rekindled that relationship with the Tertön with Dilgo Khyentse Rinpoche. So if we look at the most effective time of the internationalization of the Tibet issue and of the Dalai Lama sort of movement around the world and his effectiveness when he received the Nobel Peace Prize is when Dilgo Khyentse Rinpoche was by his side giving him teachings. It continued. He didn't finish all of the teachings that he was supposed to receive, and he said, you can go to this Lama named Choshu Rinpoche. That's what he did. And so he finished that with Choshu Rinpoche. But we see that Choshu Rinpoche died 6 or 7 years ago,
and things in Tibet have never been worse in the 14th Dalai Lama's life. They're even worse now than they were in 1959. So at least that's what I believe. And I think it has a lot to do with many different things, but this is one aspect.
So why doesn't
the 14th Dalai Lama connect with another one? Well, the 14th Dalai Lama is progressive, but he's not so progressive that he could just find any old yogi and have him come in and teach him. There are protocols, and there aren't any lamas that are senior enough, or perhaps have whatever, you know, street cred or cave credibility or however it goes that Kensi Chogyi Lodro, that Dogo Kensi Rinpoche, that these masters have.
Did the Dalai Lama ever meet in the flesh Jigme Punsok?
Yes. When Kempo Jigme Punsok came to India, he went to Dharamsala. And when they first met, they met on a balcony. When they first met, Kempo Jigme Punsok started to reveal Terma right there. And the 14th Dalai Lama grabbed a pen and paper and wrote it down. He was the scribe for a ritual, a fire puja ritual associated with the Vajrakilaya empowerment that maybe some of you received. This it's called the Vajrakilaya in an amulet or in this sort of gurpurma. He received teachings from Kempo, and he calls him his teacher. Yeah. There's one story that when Kempo Jigme Punzo went to, I could mention, you know, in the 8th century when there was a very strong element between the king of Tibet and Padmasambhava, the principal protector that they brought in there to protect the Dharma teachings, there were many, of course, but the principal one that was associated with the state was the protector called Pehar, or Nichum, the Nichum oracle, maybe some of you may have heard. It is still today is the state oracle. So at the time of the 13th Dalai Lama, these three, and I write a fair bit about he was the sort of connection between. And when Kempo Jigme Punzo went to Nichum Monastery, he was sitting there on the throne, and he began to give this empowerment, and the medium of the oracle was spontaneously possessed by Nichum, which almost never happens. They always have this big ceremony, he's got to put on the garb and dance around, and he was just sitting there in his monk clothes, and he was spontaneously possessed by Nichum, and sort of went up there and was sort of flopping around on sort of in this trance, if you will, on Kempo Jigme Punzok's lap, and they had their heads together, and then he sort of fell off, he fell down, and Nichum went away, the oracle went away, and Kempo Jigme Punzok sat there, and then he started the dedication prayers, the concluding prayers. So Kempo Namdo went up to him and said, Rinpoche, you haven't finished the empowerment. You haven't done everything that you're supposed to do. And he said, he sort of pushed him away. He said, I gave all the empowerment already just then. Mm. And so he gave it to Nichum, and he considered that he'd given it to everybody at that time. The Dalai Lama did also, when they met, when Kempo Jigme Punzok died, the Dalai Lama did something that he'd never done before. And he spoke to Radio Free Asia and Voice of America with a message specifically to go inside Tibet. And he told the students of Kempo Jigme Punzok, of which there were tens of thousands, he instructed them what to do. Mm-hmm. Which is essentially, he said, do what your teacher told you to do. But the Dalai Lama had never taken that step before to actually try to broadcast his own voice inside Tibet.
Translators, or do you speak fluent Tibetan?
Yeah, no, I don't speak fluent Tibetan. I always had, yes, I had translators along the way. I had three principal Tibetan translators, one in Lhasa and then one in sort of Kham, or one in southeastern Tibet, if you will, and one in northeastern.
Is that challenging? Is that challenging at all for you?
Not really, you know, so long as you have time in Tibet, that's the main thing. That is, if you have time, because travel is quite difficult, and people aren't always there, or the people aren't always ready to talk to you when you want to talk to them, so you might have to wait a couple weeks. you know, so, and so I always had time. I had nothing else going on. I lived in Kathmandu, and I would just wait. Yeah. It was a little, when I wrote In the Shadow of the Buddha, I actually waited because there were, of these three people who I was working with, that were translating both the political stuff I was working on and with teachers. But of course that wasn't always, it was more the conversations that I was having about just life and about Tertön Sogyal. It wasn't these high Dharma teachings. I wasn't receiving teachings there, and I wasn't, that wasn't my purpose to go there. It was more just this sort of small talk, if you, or just stories, is that's what they were translating. If it would have been Dharma teachings, I would have had to have somebody else. In Nyarong and Litong, I can get by traveling and with my, but it's a particular kind of dialect that sort of sounds like some, you know, mixture of, if you were in America, like Arkansas and Texas, with, you didn't study, you didn't go to elementary school, you know. Like, when I would speak that in Lhasa, people just cracked up. They thought, you know, just sounds like some nomad who doesn't have any education. And, grunting a few sounds, but I always had, yeah, I always had help.
I'm wondering, when you spoke to these, all these different people who are so generous with you to share this information, I know that, and you mentioned that lamas have been, and monks and have been imprisoned for, I mean, people are imprisoned there just to, if they have a photograph or a picture of the Dalai Lama. So is there any, was there any kind of concern about their sharing these stories? Mm-hmm. And how do the, does the, you know, Chinese government, you know, view that kind of thing?
So this is, you know, I stopped, my last trip was in 2008. So I'd been going there since the late 1990s, but really doing the work for 6 or 7 like solid years of the political work. So you asked if there was concern. Very definitely. It was always the principle. It was always my principle sort of thing that was on my mind. Their safety, the people who I worked with, and there were Chinese who I worked with as well. But and it was known. They knew the situation much better than I did. I would almost always follow their lead. But there, it was a very real situation that if anybody got caught, there could have been very real consequences, like imprisonment and torture and put to death. For human rights, for people who are sharing information about detainees, about people who are imprisoned, this identity, the Chinese consider this state secrets. They also consider state secrets the photographing the prisons I was taking pictures of. So, you know, we knew what I was getting into, but it was a risk. It was a risk, but it wasn't much of a risk for me. It was the risk for the people who I was working with. And before 2008, it was already, there's a bit of a shelf life for that kind of work, you know, how many times I can go back and forth. I had this cover, if you will, of some Dharma dude going around in Tertön Sogyal's footsteps, because that's what I was doing. And when this book was published, I know of about just less than a dozen people who were brought in for questioning about me. And they all said exactly the same story. They said that I was working on the biography of it, because that's what actually what I was doing. So it was a cover, but it was also what I was doing. But all the people that I worked with, the people who I worked with are no longer in Tibet or China. The people who were brought in were just somehow associated, but nothing ever happened about it. It's a very real risk. It's a different game now, though, if you will, than in 2008. China's much more confident. You know, the things have things have completely changed. They're much more confident than they were then, in terms of if they would have caught me, or they had caught other human rights monitors before. But now, you know, I'm just waiting for the time when they actually make an example of somebody that's doing this type of work, a Westerner. And they charge it, you know, when they catch them, they may, because they don't have to listen to anybody now. They own half our dad, so. Yeah. It wasn't like that. It's a completely different situation now than it was in 2008. Politically
speaking. One of the problems of traveling in the past, did you have to register where you were going?
Yeah. You know, actually, no. When you go to Tibet, if you go to central Tibet, around Lhasa, what the Tibetans call Tibet, or excuse me, what the Chinese call Tibet or Xizang, this area is called the Tibetan Autonomous Region, the official name. So if you go there, you have to, once you're in China, you have to get a bit of a, you have to get a kind of a, what's it called? You get a permit that's attached to your passport, but there's nothing in your passport that says that you're going to Tibet. Tibet's not a country, so you would never get a stamp in there, right? It's China. So I never went to central Tibet first. You know, I would just come in every which way, come in through Hong Kong, through Kunming, through Beijing, through come up through Bangkok, and then just come in from eastern Tibet and then wander around eastern Tibet. Yeah. And it was easier to do than it is now. Now it's more difficult because of the situation, because of the current situation.
So when you say they're more confident, the Chinese government, what does that mean?
I mean that that the Chinese government has no, does not, it doesn't consider into its calculus anymore, I don't think, the reaction of Western governments. It started to change with, in terms of the work that I do when it comes to from human rights work and this type of thing, that when the photographs of Abu Ghraib came out and when we opened Guantanamo Bay, the very next time that a US government official took some of the information that I had gathered, took it to Geneva, the Chinese response was, you sort yourself out in Abu Ghraib before you scold us. So we, you know, human rights monitors, that sort of community, if you will, lost the principal nation that would take our argument to the world stage when with things like that. You know, and I could go on. So that was where it began, I think, in terms of from the human rights side. From China's side, though, we've had this extraordinary rise economically of the People's Republic of China, and they disregard the importance or the need to consider outside opinions from especially from Western governments, people that would bring a sort of social justice or human rights element to it. Yeah, so that's just the fact of that's just how things are going now, and in that time. From 2008 until now, China has successfully organized whenever they discuss human rights issues or social justice issues, or even environmental issues, it's almost always with one-on-one with a country. They never do it in like a large forum like ASEAN or at the UN. They always just do bilateral. And the reason that they do this is because they have such strong economic clout that they can use that, they can say, we're not going to discuss any of these issues because we don't want to, but we will discuss trade. And so they very skillfully, in the United States, unfortunately, the Clinton administration was completely outplayed during this time and allowed China to do that, to establish all of these bilateral talks. It's very interesting in Tibet, and if you talk to Tibetans, they love George W. Bush much more than Clinton or Obama, I must say. You know, they loved George W. Bush, his way that he went about things. I mean, perhaps it's not a very nuanced analysis, but that's how they sort of see things. Yeah.
I recall you mentioning somewhere along that you work not only with a lot of Tibetans, but with some Chinese as well. So who were these Chinese?
Yeah. There were people who were concerned about social justice issues, and in particular about issues having to do with education and allowing Tibetans to study, or to not only study, they can actually study in Tibetan, but it's mainly how they're examined. So for higher education, for undergrad and for graduate school, to get into to have access to higher education, you have to take those examinations in Chinese, in Mandarin. So you can study Tibetan, but you're never really the examinations won't take you to a higher education. So it, oftentimes it had to do with that, and that a lot of the documentation that I was bringing out had to do with education policy, and in particular with language in Sichuan province. And then there were the Chinese that are associated with Harry Wu, who is a Chinese dissident who had documented the Lao Gai, the prison labor camps, and he lives in Washington, D.C. now, spent time in prison labor camps. The people who I was associated vis-a-vis him would help me figure out where these labor camps were, because they, you know, they don't say labor camp on them. They're almost always were leather tanning shops, but then you look behind it and it's, you know, it's a huge thing, leather tanning or a kind of mechanic or auto parts kind of thing. And so you, oftentimes they had, there was some element of labor going on, but most of the time in Tibet at least, it was simply for detention. And so I would take these photographs, I would just get up above them somehow and take pictures to get inside, or I would send disposable cameras in to the prison and then receive them back, and then that was the other way. Things have changed now, you know, I don't know if I would, I wouldn't recommend doing it now, but.
You know. Did you ever come across any prophecies on how the current situation in Tibet would unfold?
Completely. When I was going through the biography of Tertön Sogyal, this Lama Karma, who I showed you a picture of, he was highlighting everything, like many times. I said, I have to tell the Dalai Lama this. And he's got sort of access through the to the Nature Oracle. And there was a lot of, and you know, it didn't say in this year, but it would have these sort of prophecies about the kinds of malaise that were going on, or the kinds of problems. But I have to say that in reading, and when you read this, or if you read it, you'll see some of the same problems that the Tibetans are creating for themselves, they're still doing today. And it's extraordinary. It's, you know, in reading that history, and you sort of see it now, I mean, I think that it's not only with Tibet, we see that with ourselves. I mean, you know, history repeats itself, you know? And if, especially from a Buddhist perspective, we have a kind of tendency to do the things that we've done in the past. We have this sort of, we've got these grooves that we fall into. And so you could sort of completely see this playing out in the 1890s, 1904, especially right after Tertön Sogyal died and right before the 13th Dalai Lama passed away. And I talk about what's going on there. Those situations are the exact same problems that the 14th Dalai Lama has been dealing with for 20 years in his own community.
Matteo, could you say a little bit about how Tertön Sogyal aligned himself with the political forces of his time in Tibet, or not? I mean, obviously
yeah.
he could see through it.
Yeah.
But how did he work
yeah.
with that?
It's a good question. Because sometimes I think, you know, even in my first book, I kind of wrote about Tertön Sogyal as if he was sort of a socially engaged Buddhist, you know? As we sort of talk about now at Thich Nhat Hanh or Suluxiva Raksha, these people sort of talk about. But in writing this, I came to the conclusion, I don't know if that's completely correct. I think I was incorrect in sort of seeing Tertön Sogyal that way. Tertön Sogyal was doing, he was... you could even say obsessed with finding prophecies or carrying out the prophecies, finding taramas and revealing those and practicing those taramas. It was all he did all day, every day, his whole life. And in the you could see in his biography, he's going everywhere. He's always sort of upset or impatient about getting things done, about bringing the right people together, about bringing the right substances together for the rituals, all of this. That was his entire universe. And why was he doing this? Because he, like the Dalai Lamas, like the kings of Tibet of the past, were trying to create the most conducive circumstances for spiritual practice in his homeland. So whether that place was called Tibet, or whether it had a border, I don't think it mattered so much with Tertön Sogyal. It was that there was going to be some obstacles in the form of these demons that are coming from the south, called the English, or the demons that were coming from the east in the form of the Qing dynasty, or in the northeast, the Muslim warlords who were destroying monasteries. That this idea that when we see it, I would ask Orgon Topyal, I would say, these demons that is written in Tibetan, these demons,
who are they talking to? Who, you know, name some names here. And he always knew who they were, Ordian Tokyel did, you know. In Lhasa, Tertön Sogyal sometimes doesn't name by name the Tibetans who he was confronting, but I asked Ordian Tokyel and Comte Rinpoche, and they always confirmed exactly who it was. So sometimes I think that, but the point is Tertön Sogyal, he didn't align himself politically. He was doing what needed to be done to create these conducive circumstances for spiritual practice, but not on it from his own thinking, not by his own ingenuity. It was just what Guru Rinpoche, it was what Padmasambhava told him to do. It's all written out. He said, if you would just do this, then everything would take care of itself. And so he, there's many stories, and then also in his biography, where he's reprimanding people for not doing what Padmasambhava says. You're not building the requisite stupas, you're not empowering those requisite stupas, you're not doing these rituals on this particular type of calendar, you're not doing what Padmasambhava says to do. And so I write a lot about this. I wouldn't say exactly, I would say impatient. He was driven for this, even when he got to be very old. You know, the last years of his life, he was still always gathering people around him to do these various ritual practices. I'll tell you one, you know, when he went back in 1904, on the way back to, that was the last time when he left Lhasa for the last time, and I think he was pretty frustrated with what was happening in Lhasa with the Tibetan government. When he went back and he got chased out from Nyarong, from his home, and he went up into northeastern Tibet, into Omdo, on his route there was a prophecy about a stone that had the power, this lado, had this power to revitalize and protect the life of the Dalai Lamas. And so he was told this prophecy that there's this stone that on one side had two different mantras and had two different deities on either side of it. And then he needed to discover this. So it was kind of obsessed. You know, Jamingkhadze Wangpo wrote, prophecies are the downfall of Tertons.
Oh, no.
Because they, like, once they hear it, they just go, it's just, they have to find it. Tertön Sogyal didn't find it it took him about 12 or 13 years to finally find this. And he was constantly doing pujas, rituals, trying to remove the obscurations in himself or others, or trying to align the different circumstances. So finally, when he got sort of like wind by a vision, he had a vision, and they said, when you have a meditative experience, wherever you are, walk up the mountain and then go from there. So he had been circumambulating this mountain with this assistant that he had, this young girl that was with him, and one monk. They were sort of circumambulating this mountain, and that evening he had this sort of meditative experience, and the young yogini also had the same experience. And so Tertön Sogyal said, okay, we're going to go up. So he goes up this, and they go up, and they climb up in this cave, and then they look down, and there's just this huge chasm. They can't see down, so they're holding their butter lamp, they can't see. So he sent his monk back down to get some rope, some hemp or something, and then they tie it off, and he lowers himself down, and he knows that this is the place, and he was excited that he was going to find this. He sits down, place is covered with this little lake is covered with ice, so he starts banging with a rock, and he had his assistant with some sort of hatchet, and finally this big piece of ice falls in, and Tertön Sogyal puts his hand in, and the spirit or the water protector that is there hands him this stone, and he holds it up, and he has this incredible relief, this incredible satisfaction that he finally has a stone. He didn't know at the time though that it needed to reach the Dalai Lama, but so he put it here, and then he put his other hand in because he wanted something else, and they handed him a statue. And so he looked at it like this, and when he looked at it, he realized the ring that had been on his finger, that he'd been wearing for quite a while, that a young nun had given him, that had a piece of coral in it, and told him that he needed to recite mantra and blow on it, and this would provide a kind of ritual, a kind of a orb of protection, because Tertön Sogyal had to deal with black magic a lot. People were trying to come at him, so he was having to ricochet it back a lot. So this was, this ring and the mantra and everything was creating this protection for him. It was gone. So he had this sinking feeling.
and this is written in, this isn't a story, this is actually written in Tertön Sogyal's biography, he had this sort of sinking feeling. And then this voice comes from underneath, and it's the protector, and it's a female, and she's laughing. And she says, "Oh, Sogyal," she says, "I give you two treasures, and I take the ring, and you feel disappointed that I took your ring, ha ha ha," and sort of like teasing him and making fun of him for sort of feeling bad and sort of scolding him a little bit, like this. So this stone that he had, he kept this for until he died. He went everywhere with it, and he would set it up against other rocks and bless other rocks and empower the rocks, and he made many, many, many replicas of it and sent it around Tibet and sent this lado around. And finally, right before he passed away, he sealed it and sent it to Lhasa. And it arrived into the care of the 13th Dalai Lama. There's two different stories how it arrived, but when the 14th Dalai Lama in 1959, March 1959, was when the bombs were falling in the Norbalinga, his palace, in the Norbalinga garden, and he fled under the cover of night, the Dalai Lama sort of dressed in layman's clothes and sort of fled and was able to arrive in safely in exile. This stone is what he wore as his protection. So I heard this story and I was like, I'd heard it from people who liked Tertön Sogyal, and Tibetans are sometimes prone to a little bit of exaggeration in their hagiographical sort of stories of their lamas. So I asked the Dalai Lama and I asked him about that, and he said, "Oh yes," and I said, "Well, you had all of these amazing treasures. Why did you take that?" And he said, I want to know that he had everything. He could have taken anything from the portal of Norbalinga. And he said, "Actually, I was just in this room, and they said we had to leave right now, and you know, you're not going to prepare anything." And so on the shrine, there just happened to be that and a purba. And so he put the purba in his belt, and he put this in a sort of sack that he wore right here. And that's what he wore into exile. Our Lama Sogyal Rinpoche has seen it, and Dilgo Khenzo Rinpoche writes about it, and Khomtra Rinpoche writes about it. I've never seen it myself. Great. Maybe one last one, or two last
ones. Given the importance of hidden teachings and buried treasures that get revealed, and Tertön Sogyal's relationship with the political, when you were going on your journey and you would talk to these lamas and these wise people, did you ever glean any sense of what might be hidden teaching for what's coming now in terms of these being the worst days?
Yeah. Yeah. There are treasure teachings being revealed now. Even a couple of the treasure teachings that Tertön Sogyal revealed, many of his treasure teachings were sort of one-time things. They were just meant for one obstacle to remove something for the Dalai Lama. He has 19 volumes of treasure teachings. But many of those are just these sort of aren't practiced. But there are a couple, in particular two, that are meant to be practiced right now for the benefit of the Tibetan, for the benefit of the Dalai Lama's long life and the Tibetan government, if you will. But there are other Tertöns alive today that are also revealing treasures. At the time of Tertön Sogyal, when he was alive, he was definitely, because Jamin Khenzi Wangpo and Jamin Khonchol, after they passed away, Tertön Sogyal was definitely the most important treasure revealer of his time. And his relationship with the 13th Dalai Lama, I think, is testament to that. There were a couple, right before Tertön Sogyal's time, it was really this extraordinary period with Khenzi Wangpo and Jamin Khonchol and Chogyur Lingpa and many other lamas, actually. So today, there are treasure revelations happening specifically, but I don't know of them so much. You know, there are academics that are working on this, that are writing about these things, but maybe it's a little bit easier when you're about 20 years or 50 years or 100 years out to sort of look back and sort of see what those are. I'll say this, the last thing I'll say is in 2008, when Tibet was on fire and everything, it was a real dire situation. When I went to with then Speaker Nancy Pelosi to India, she was on doing some climate change thing, but she took a whole delegation up to the Dalai Lama's residence, and I was there to sort of hang around. And during the meeting, it was going on a little long, and it was in the Dalai Lama's residence, and there was a chapel right by, and so I could hear the pounding of the drum and And so I wanted to see what was going on, and I actually stepped out and I went in there to see. And it was Khomtur Rinpoche who you saw there with the Nejum Oracle and all the Dalai Lama's monks from Namgyal. And they were doing Yamnyin Pudri. They were doing the Tertön Sogyal's principle, one of the four Vajrahilaya teaching or practices that he had revealed. And the Dalai Lama had ordered that to be sort of extended rituals that last maybe 10, 11 days, three of them consecutively. And I kind of felt it was very appropriate that it was there. All the lamas had these purbas, these ritual daggers in front of them, and I think the Tibetans, they have to work every angle they can, you know. Yeah. So, thanks so much. Yeah.
Thank you so much, and he's graciously agreed to greet and sign a few remaining copies he has of both
sure.
of his books.
Yeah.
So thank you again. We'll come back again soon for your third book.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, thanks so much.